All right, well, good morning. It is good to see you this morning. We are glad that you are with us in person or online. My name is Vance, and I am the junior high pastor here. Probably many of you, like me, have kids, and maybe you're in the same boat as me, that you are absolutely dumbfounded that there is only 1 week left of school. It's just amazing how quick that goes. And some of you, actually, I see some faces I know that are like, yeah, 1 week, like forever, because our kids are graduating. But as these last few weeks have gone by, I've gotten to go to several different school events, like the end of school year things, and whether it's just participating and watching or helping and serving, I have just been reminded of how good it is to be together, to be with these other parents. And at the same time, though, I'm just reminded that, like, for some of them, I've seen them two or three times a year. That's it. I saw them at the school thing at the beginning of the year, the hey, welcome. Saw them around Christmas. There was some kind of program. Saw them at the end. And it really struck me, truthfully, how different things are here at the church and how blessed we are. Like, we actually have a weekly gathering. Like, we actually every week get a chance to see each other. Like, I can stand out here in the courtyard and I can smile at you and wave and say hi when you walk in, and you have to see me if I'm out there. You don't have a choice. But it is such an amazing blessing that we every week get a chance to do that. Like, there's this thing that God has given us, this opportunity where I get to let God love you through me, and I get to receive his love through you every week, just the way it works. And it's such an incredible thing. And so I was, again, struck by that kind of rarity of that, of getting to see people each week, but also reminded of how good it is, how good it is to be together, how good it is to see people, and how important that is. And so this morning we get to worship this God who loves us through each other, and just individually. And I'm just going to start with just a prayer of asking God to help us do that well as we love each other and as we love him. God, thank you so much for really how you've made us with this desire, this ability to love, to be loved by others. And I do pray that you would help us to be really attentive to that, to be aware of how incredible that is and what a blessing it is. I pray that you can love others well through us. And I pray that we also will receive your love from those that we interact with and bump into. And we just praise you and look forward to our time with you this morning. Amen.
Please stand with us this morning. The King of love, my shepherd is, whose goodness faileth never. Nothing lack if I am his, and he's mine forever, and he's mine forever. Streams of living water flow, my ransom. Shepherd, may I sing your praise within your house forever, within your house forever. Thank you. by the fury of your love, you stepped into my Egypt. You took me by the hand. You marched me out in freedom into the promised land. Now I will not forget you, no. I'll sing of all you've done. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of your love.
Father of the middle spaces, the unknown and disorienting, where frustration and cynicism beckon. Make us a people of mystery. Teach us to restore where others tear down, and to be your compassionate voice in a world prone to vivid extremity.
Faithfulness, faithfulness.
good and gracious God, our Heavenly Father, you have never failed us. God, it's our prayer this morning that when our trust in that faithfulness starts to waver, God, that you would be there to catch us. That when the world seems like too much, that we would trust, God, that just like you have helped us and saved us and carried us so many times, God, that you would do it again. We give you thanks and we give you praise for that rock steady dedication and love to us that we receive from you, even when we don't see it or understand it. And God, we give you the remainder of this service of worship. Lord, would you be pleased with our offering this day? It's in the name of Jesus that we pray all of these things. Amen. Amen, amen. And you may have a seat this morning, but only some of you will be seated for a short time. And I say that because this morning we have an exciting opportunity to recognize our graduates. I am up here this morning. My name is Preston. I have the opportunity and the privilege to lead our high school and college young adult ministries. And so it is my privilege to be preaching and coming to you with the word today on this graduate emphasis Sunday that we have going on this morning. So this is what we're going to do before we get started or before we go any further. And we're going to do this on kind of a small scale in case you're someone who gets embarrassed. We're not going to bring anybody up on stage. But what we would like to do is that if you are graduating or have graduated this season from either high school or college or seminary or any kind of tech school, anything at all, we would like for you at this time to go ahead and stand so that we can recognize you with a round of applause and to honor you for your achievements. So if you have a graduate sitting near you and they're not standing, give them a little bit of a nudge so that they can go ahead and do that now. So, and I want you to remain standing because now what we'd like to do, we understand that you graduates did not make it here all by yourselves. So if you are the parent or the grandparent or the coach or a pastor or a counselor or a mail carrier or anything at all for any of these graduates, we would like for you to stand as well. If you are connected to these graduates and you helped boot them across the finish line, we want to recognize you as well. So, as you are seated, we do want to recognize you. And today, as I bring to you the word from the book of Joshua, of all places, we will be recognizing and emphasizing your achievement today, graduates. But for now, let us take just a moment to release our children to Sunday school and children's ministry. And so if you would raise your hand with me in the direction towards our children as our children stand to receive our blessing this morning. May you know that your Heavenly Father loves you. May you know that in Jesus you have been accepted into God's family. May you set your hearts on things from above, the things that matter most to God: love, forgiveness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and kindness. God has chosen you and calls you his child. As you go, may you be rooted in his redeeming love. Amen and amen. So when we celebrate a group of people, it's a beautiful thing to see just how far the ripples of support go. And that's why we had all of you stand who were connected to these graduates in some way. But it's also kind of interesting and maybe even a little bit curious to some of you why we would have something like a graduation emphasis in a service of worship in the church. You might be thinking to yourself, don't the schools kind of handle that? Don't we handle that kind of in-house in our families and we throw the parties and we send out the invitations and it kind of stops there, right? Why would we dedicate a service of worship to our graduations? And maybe even beyond that, you may be thinking, isn't honoring graduates in the church just kind of ushering human beings up in front of other human beings to honor and recognize a human achievement or accomplishment? So to explore this, I want us to take a journey. To answer that question, I want us to take a journey together. And it's just a few thousand years back in time to the other side of the world To try to gain some perspective on why celebrating something like a graduation, and even celebrating it in the church as an act of worship, is a good idea. So we'll do this together to see how God not only wants us to do this, but how when we do something like mark the milestone of a graduation, when we mark the milestones of our lives, we do so as a way to tell our story, but to also tell the story of God. We do this with all kinds of celebrations as human beings. We do it with birthdays, we do it with weddings, we do it with anniversaries, and we do it with graduations. I'm actually in the special, unique position of celebrating a 15-year wedding anniversary with somebody who just graduated just this week. So when you see my wife, it's Dr. Turley from now on, okay? Guys, when we celebrate graduations, it's not just to usher human beings up in front of other human beings for the sake of celebration. It's to tell their story, and in so doing, tell God's story. So let's head all the way back in time to the book of Joshua in the Old Testament. And we start off the book of Joshua with some sad news. Moses has died. He's buried, and nobody really knows where he is buried, and that's a whole other conversation. But what we do know is that Joshua, who was an aide of Moses, had been tapped by God to be the next leader of Israel. And we're going to pick up with him and the Israelites, the people through whom God has chosen to work out his story on earth, in Joshua chapter 1, verses 10 through 11. And just very quickly, up to this point, the people of Israel had been through a lot. They had been enslaved in Egypt. They had been miraculously delivered from slavery. They'd been wandering in the desert. They disobeyed and even disappointed God countless times, but still we find God invested and interested in their lives and calling their lives to new and better seasons. So let's pick up with them here in verse 10, keeping those things in mind. Verse 10 says this: "So Joshua ordered the officers of the people, 'Go through the camp and tell the people, get your provisions ready. 3 days from now, you will cross the Jordan here to go in and take possession of the land the Lord your God is giving you for your own.'" So friends, the promise of the promised land is finally, literally, just across the river. Moses has died, and Joshua has been called by God to lead his people across the Jordan River into the land that God had promised them. The Israelite people are being called to something new. A new season of life awaits them on the other side of that river. And I love this image for our graduate focus today, because just like the people of Israel who are being called to something new, something exciting, but also something a little bit scary, you who are graduating a while back, a few years ago, were called to something new, something exciting, but something a little bit scary. The story of the Israelite people mirrors so beautifully the story of every graduate that's in this room today. And as we'll even touch on, the story is not just for our graduates. But for now, we're going to talk about how the story of Israel weaves in and out of your story this morning, graduates. How the same God who called them to this new season is the same God who called you to the season that was the last 3 or 4 years of your life. And while the circumstances around those callings look very different, the same God who calls is the same God who carries and sustains. And on the other side of the achievement of that milestone, wants us to celebrate one another and to celebrate him. That same God really hasn't changed much at all. And you know, this story of Joshua and Israel is really quite amazing. Between the time God taps Joshua to lead his people across into the promised land and the time where they actually cross it, there's so much that's going on. And we don't have time to go into all of it today, but just know it's a crazy story. So go home after lunch and read in the book of Joshua, because it's fascinating reading. There's spies that are sent off into the land, and these spies end up in the home of a prostitute named Rahab, and she hides them from the people who are trying to find them and kill them. And then her life is protected when Israel comes back and eventually claims the town of Jericho, she leaves. And I share all of this and all of these details to make clear that what God is calling his people to carries with it all kinds of things. It obviously carries with it the opportunity and the possibility for victory. And today we celebrate your victory as graduates. But it also carries with it risk. It carries with it all but guaranteed hardship. It carries with it the need to think critically. Ultimately, to rely on and remember God through the entire process. So, you know, to have had all of this out in front of them, the Israelite people must have been feeling a lot of things, just like you were feeling all those years ago when you stepped into that first class. Excitement, anticipation, wonder, fear, all kinds of things. When God calls us into new seasons, we feel a lot of stuff. We're human beings, and when human beings get called by God to something, even called to participate in the divine, and that's what you did, by the way, when you completed your course of schooling. We'll talk about that in just a second. We have a tendency to maybe waver a little bit when we step into that space. And we have to remember also that the people of Israel were just that. They were just people. People trying and usually failing to listen to and obey God. Here at the shore of the Jordan River, there lay ahead of them a new season of life, a calling that if they responded to it, would surely carry with it the possibility of victory and a whole new world of blessing and a whole new world of opportunity. So to our graduates in the room today, reflect back on the weeks and even days before you started that freshman year of high school or that freshman year of college or that first course in seminary or that first course in school. What was rolling through your mind? What was rolling through your heart? Remember that list that I just shared? I imagine that list of things that include excitement, anticipation, maybe a little bit of fear, it's probably where your heart and head were hanging out. But grads, whether you knew it or not, God was not only with you, he had placed you there in that place in time, and he had called you there to that season, to step into the river of something new. You were called, you were never abandoned. And just like the Israelites, in the next part of our story, you were carried through that entire season. Just like Israel was about to participate in God's story, you took part in God's story when you stepped into that first class all those years ago. So we're going to jump back into Scripture now, into chapter 3 in the book of Joshua. We're going to pick up with verse 14 to see a little bit more about why the implications or the details of the story of the people of Israel has implications for our story, for our graduates this morning. So verse 14 starts out with this. So when the people broke camp to cross the Jordan, the priest carrying the Ark of the Covenant went ahead of them. Now the Jordan is at flood stage all during harvest. Yet as soon as the priests who carry the ark reached the Jordan and their feet touched the water's edge, the water from upstream stopped flowing. Piled up in a heap a great distance away at a town called Adam in the vicinity of Zetharim, while the water flowing down to the Sea of Arabah, that is the Dead Sea, was completely cut off. So the people crossed over opposite Jericho. The priests who carry the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord stopped in the middle of the Jordan and stood on dry ground, while all Israel passed by until the whole nation had completed the crossing on dry ground. God carried the Israelites through what seemed to be impossible and brought them out safe on the other side. And now I know everyone in this room who has ever graduated from anything. I'm talking all the way back to pre-kindergarten, all the way through whatever advanced degree is available. At some point during that process, at some point during those years, you thought to yourself, this whole thing is going to come crashing down. You thought, if I just quit now, everything will be okay, and life can go back to normal just like it was, and it'll just be better for everyone. Right? We all had those thoughts at some point along the way. But the Israelites stepped to the water's edge, and God piled up the waters in a heap, and they crossed through on dry land. The impossible became possible with God. And that is a perfect description of every graduate's journey. You know, and even in their obedience, we need to be reminded again that the Israelites were people just like you and I, prone to doubts and fears and hesitations and second guessing, all of that. You know, it doesn't explicitly say this in Scripture, but you and I both know that when that line started across the Jordan on that day, that at least a few of those people were thinking to themselves as they stood in the middle of a river that moments before had been full of water, and they looked to this side and they saw a wall of water standing in free space. They thought to themselves, maybe this wasn't the best idea for me in my life right now. If you're familiar with the Enneagram, you know there were Enneagram sixes in that group who thought, we did not have a strategic plan for this, we just did it, and that was a big mistake. Okay? They felt stuck. They felt confused. They saw a wall of water that in the back of their minds they just knew was going to come crashing down at any moment. What we're getting at here, friends, is that the Israelites were not just calm little characters in some play that God was putting on. No, they were people, just like you and I are people. So let's not put them up on a pedestal and think that this was an easy transition for them to make or an easy season for them to step into. Real people with real hearts and brains and fears and doubts. But they put their foot in, they kept putting one foot in front of the other, and eventually found themselves on dry land. And graduates, you put one foot down, you went to that first class, you went to that second class, you wrote that first paper and that second paper and that 25th paper and that 400th paper, and you did it. You responded. And even as the water wall of doubt swirled right next to your face, you made it. So congratulations, graduate. And I do not say congratulations lightly. Monta Vista Chapel does not recognize your achievement lightly. We don't say it lightly because our extension of congratulations is more than just some pat, pre-programmed response that we say to people this time of year. Remember a moment ago when I said that your journey towards graduation was part of God's story? Well, it is. With our congrats comes the retelling of God's story of how he has called you to something, how he carried you through that something, and he has now brought you through safely to the other side. Your story, your journey of completing your degree is the retelling of God's story. That is why with our congratulations comes so much more than just a pat, pre-programmed response. Our congrats comes with an encouragement for you to let this milestone be marked, to let it be marked not only for your sake, but for the sake of the God who brought you through. So now I want to rejoin our friends, the people of Israel, now that they are on the other side of the Jordan River, and see how they would mark their own accomplishment. So we pick up the story again in the fourth chapter of Joshua, beginning with the first verse. So let's read that together. When the whole nation had finished crossing the Jordan, the Lord said to Joshua, "Choose 12 men from among the people, one from each tribe, and tell them to take up 12 stones from the middle of the Jordan, from right where the priests were standing, and carry them over with you and put them down at the place where you stay tonight." So Joshua called together the 12 men that he had appointed from the Israelites, one from each tribe, and said to them, "Go over before the ark of the Lord your God into the middle of the Jordan. Each of you is to take up a stone on his shoulder, according to the number of the tribes of the Israelites, to serve as a sign among you. In the future, when your children ask you, 'What do these stones mean?' tell them that the flow of the Jordan was cut off before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord. And when it crossed the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan were cut off. These stones are to be a memorial to the people of Israel forever." So, church, in the seemingly bizarre act of finding and piling up 12 rocks, the people of Israel model for us why it's important and even worshipful for us to mark the milestones of our lives. See, in their story, actual stones were used as a way to memorialize their trust in God and God's deliverance of them through a very challenging season. For all of our graduates present with us here today, our choice to celebrate you is rooted in our desire to point to what God has accomplished in the story of your life up to this date. So you probably don't have a pile of 12 rocks piled up to commemorate your graduation, but you were given a little square hat, you were given a tassel, you were given a robe, or as your parents know, you probably had to purchase all those things, but that's neither here nor there. And none of those things, if we think about it, if we think, well, this seems like such an odd, arbitrary thing to find 12 rocks and to pile them up, it's an odd, arbitrary thing to wear a square on your head and then to throw it up in the sky. That doesn't have any more real significance, right? These things are all symbols that have had value attributed to them, all to point back to your accomplishment, all to point back to how good God has been in your life. You know, I love the way human beings get together to celebrate other human beings. We do this all the time. Human beings love a party, right? And if you think about it, the very act of celebrating is kind of a uniquely human thing. You know, in the church, we believe that our ultimate uniqueness as human beings lies in the fact that we have been created in the image of God. And I like to think that it is that image of God in us that draws us towards celebration, that draws us to celebrate one another. And then we do, we get to kind of practice and participate in that God image that lives inside each and every one of us. So when we order and eat those cakes, those weird ones, you know, that have like the photograph screen printed on them, that is at every graduation party, and the icing's kind of gross and weird right at that point because it's kind of sticky or whatever. Guys, that's a symbol that points back to God's story being played out in your life. When we order balloon bouquets and when we fill up bulletin boards full of embarrassing pictures of the graduate, right? From their toddler years to their braces years and all the way through to their senior pictures. And when we get chairs from the church to fill up our garages or our barns or our spaces, or we sit in church halls and we have punch bowls and we send out invitations and we text and email electronic invitations to these gatherings. It's more than just a party. It's more than just a cake. It's more than just a square hat. It is the marking of a milestone to point back to God's goodness in your life. You know, human beings were wired to assign meaning to things and celebrate and mark life's moments. God knew that when he called those people to say, you know, now that I've accomplished this thing in your life, go pick up 12 rocks from out there in that river and pile them up into a tower so that my presence and my hand in your life can be visible not only now, but for generations to come. We're wired to assign meaning to things and celebrate and mark life's moments. To that point, I want to share with you one of my favorite quotes, one of the best quotes I've ever heard in my entire life. It's by a guy named Ian Morgan Cron. And Cron is a worship leader, he's a songwriter, he's a pastor, he's an author, he's a lot of different things. And years ago, I had the opportunity to attend a conference where he was giving a workshop. And during this workshop, he made a statement that points to exactly what I'm talking about this morning, about how we as human beings are drawn to ceremony, and how even in the church, how ceremony is a special and a sacred thing. And this is how he phrased it. He said, you know, dogs don't get married and birds don't have funerals. And I said, well, that what? I mean, you're right, but why would you say that? That seems like an odd thing. But the more I let it rest on my heart, I caught the truth of what he was trying to say. And it points back to a moment ago when I said, it is God's image in us and our opportunity and our ability to participate in that image when we celebrate one another through things like weddings and anniversaries, and today, graduations. We're wired, we have like this second sight to assign meaning to things. So today, graduates, we celebrate you, not only to lift you up, and we do that, and we celebrate you and all of you that you have accomplished, but know that in that celebration, we point right back to the God who carried you through the entire journey and the entire process. As humans, we have the ability to attach meaning to things like rocks and cakes and square caps. but it is only valuable if they point back to God, whether it's a pile of 12 rocks or anything else. When we celebrate, we orient ourselves back to the God who made it all possible. Grads, with your accomplishments and the people who helped carry you through them is the story of God, being told and lived out by the people of God. It's as simple as that. You know, as you look at what you've accomplished, consider what might be down the line your pile of 12 stones that will remind you of how God carried you through. So whether that's your diploma prominently displayed on your wall, or it's a photo from your graduation ceremony or a photo from your graduation party put up on a shelf so that when you see it, you do more than have like a warm, fuzzy memory, but you pause long enough to fall on your knees, whether actually or just in your heart, to attribute to God the worth and the glory and the praise that He is due for bringing you through all of that. Do this and remember that these markers make your life a visible reminder to those around you and for those who will come after you. You know, we've talked a lot about Joshua and Israel and our graduates today, but before we leave today, I want to remind everyone here that this story is not just for our graduates, that the truth that this story is based on is not just limited to people who have a diploma. So to anyone here who never set out to graduate from any formal institution, or to anyone here who maybe did set out to graduate from a formal institution and it just didn't pan out, or you set out to graduate from an institution and you decided and you heard and felt the voice of God saying, this is not my plan for you right now. For all of you, know that you are still called to mark and to celebrate the milestones of your own life. This message is for you because God's calling on your life does not necessarily look like God's calling in anyone else's life. You know, another little part of this story from Joshua that we didn't have time to really flesh out entirely today is a story that there were actually 2.5 tribes from the nation of Israel who didn't cross the Jordan River that day because God had called them to stay on the east side of the river and to plant themselves there, to raise their families there, and that was His calling on the lives of those particular people. And to that calling, those people were obedient. So having or not having a diploma does not mean that you either have or have not obeyed God or followed God's plan for your life. Having or not having a diploma does not include you or exclude you from marking the meaningful seasons of your life with celebration and using those celebrations as an opportunity to tell the story of how God has worked and is working in your life. You know, and lastly, maybe you're here this morning and you feel like God is calling you to a new season of some kind. Maybe even a season of furthering your education. Maybe what God has in plan for you or in store for you is to take that step. That step that our graduates took 2, 3, 4 years ago, maybe that step is what lies on the horizon for you. Maybe you've got that nudge from the Holy Spirit and saying, you know, now might be the time. Friends, be encouraged to let that call, that dream, that nudge, just sit with you for a little while. If it is from God and you prayerfully work out that call in community with other believers that you love and trust and believers who love and trust you, He will see you all the way through to the other side of that call, of that dream, of that nudge. We've seen that He did it with the people of Israel. He carried them through. We've seen that He's done that with our graduates this morning. He's carried them through. So if you feel like God is speaking to you this morning, that God has a new season of something right out there in front of you, be encouraged to dip your toe into the water of that dream and trust that He will never let you go. So to our graduates, congratulations. remember that that congratulations from all of us here at Monte Vista Chapel is not just a pat response. We want you to soak in the joy of this moment and know that this moment is yours, but it's not just yours, okay? We want you to know that this moment is also God's, that as you tell the story, you also get to tell God's story. So toast that diploma. If you're in high school, use apple cider, but toast that diploma. Take 1,000 pictures. And as you do, pause long enough to say a prayer of thanks, a prayer asking God to open you to how you might use that diploma, that photograph, that memory, how you might use that to tell his story now and to the generations that come behind you. Mark it, friends. Mark the milestone. Remember it and use it as a chance to live into all that God has in store for you. Graduates, mark your milestone. And congratulations. Would you pray with me? Our Heavenly Father, we are grateful today for the graduates in our community and their entire support system that brought them to this joyous day. Lord, as they're kind of basking in the moment and swimming around with all of the details that surround this moment, Lord, help them to be mindful of not only the people that carried them this far, but mindful of the fact that you have carried them this far. We give you thanks for their achievement, and we pray, God, that with every graduate, no matter what field they find themselves in, that they would reflect you everywhere they go, that they would point back to you in everything that they do, and that whatever marker they choose to remember this milestone, whatever symbol they choose, God, that it would all point back to you and your glory. It's in Jesus' name we pray all of these things. Amen. So friends, thank you for being here today. If you see a graduate out in the courtyard, pat them on the back, congratulate them, and we will celebrate together here as a community. Friends, you're invited now to receive the parting blessing. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.